house, the fullest house I think I've ever seen, here to see David Droga. Nearly 2 years ago, the phone rang at my Syracuse desk. It was the head of our Atlanta office calling to say that we'd lost some business in our Atlanta office. And I always ask a standard question, okay, to what agency do we lose the business before I'm ready to growl? And the answer was Droga 5. And I didn't growl. I figured if I have to lose business, I want to lose it to the best agency in the world. So he's here. We spent the day, since I picked him up at the airport, we toured the campus, took him into Dineen Hall so we could see what a modern classroom building looks like. We went all over the campus, looked at some buildings. But David's very generous for taking a full day off to come here today. And in case you haven't heard why he's generous at this particular moment, it's because Droga 5 is Agency of the Year. And tomorrow in New York City, there'll be a get-together of all the A-list agencies. You going?
I am.
You are? You should. You should. Of all the A-list agencies. And let me tell you a bit about Droga 5. First, David's keeping a promise. We talked last year at the Advertising Hall of Fame dinner, and he's smiling. And I made the ask, and I said, David, would you come up to Syracuse University and speak at Newhouse? And he said, yeah, he would. But I got to tell you that this is a man of his word, because of all of the luminaries that I've invited to speak here, David was the lowest maintenance of any I can think of. There weren't any hiccups during the course of the year. There weren't any second thoughts. He was steadfast, and he showed up today. Droga is headquartered in New York. They have a London office. They've been on the Ad Age A-list 9 times. And they're the only agency to appear on the Ad Age A-list over 6 consecutive years. Plus, Droga 5 is one of the few advertising agencies, to be named one of Fast Company's world's most innovative companies. Prior to founding Droga 5, nearly 10 years ago, May is their 10th anniversary, David was the first ever worldwide chief creative officer of the Publicis Network. First worldwide chief creative officer of the network. And before that, he was executive creative director of Saatchi & Saatchi London and regional creative director of Saatchi & Saatchi Asia, where he and Brian Sheehan worked together. How many years ago was that?
Long time ago.
Okay. Long enough. And before that, David was partner and executive creative director of the Oman agency in Sydney. To date, David is the most awarded creative at the Cannes International Festival of Creativity, the most awarded, and the youngest person ever inducted into the New York Art Directors Club Hall of Fame. Last year, Adweek named Droga one of the top 100 most influential leaders in marketing, media, and technology. Now, lest you think that David is all business, he's not. He's got a family, he's got 4 kids, he's got motorbikes, he likes to live dangerously, but he's also a big sports fan. So before I actually took him here into this building earlier today, we went up and looked at the statues of Jim Brown, Ernie Davis, and Floyd Little, and I think David was actually thrilled to see those statues, and he was very thrilled to see Jim Brown's. So David, I'm here, you're there, you got to come up here, and I got to go down there. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to David Droga.
Thank you. Well, you know, I don't know if I can live up to that introduction.
How you doing? You've all taken this time off to come and hear me talk. Let me just start by saying I appreciate it. It's actually an honor for me to come here. You asked why I said, why did I say yes and why did I come? You know, I try not to give too many speeches or too many talks, and, you know, I'm fortunate enough to be asked to go to a lot of events, and I usually politely decline. But I have an absolute soft spot for talking to students and people who are at the most important stage of our industry, which is the beginning. And that's because I started where you were as a student and know how important it is and how anxious and exciting it all is. So it's an honour for me to be here. It's also good for me. It's healthy for me. Like, I hope there's something that I say that resonates with you, but also it's important for me to remind myself what I believe and what I stand for. And, you know, I can get caught up in my own bullshit and our own success, and I don't want to do that. And I want to remind myself that, you know, we're all in this together. By the way, motorbikes, dirt bikes, not road bikes. I'm a dirt bike guy. Huge difference in type of person. Here we are. Three things, actually, to start with. It's funny because there was this email blast that went out last week and it said, you know, Dave Droga, CEO of Droga 5. Not a CEO, not a CEO type of person, never wanted to be a CEO in my life. I'm creative chairman of Droga 5. That's actually a made-up title. It means nothing. When I created that title, I thought chairman was boring, so I said, all right, I'll be creative chairman. The irony of that is now there's creative chairmans all over our industry, and I'm like, that was just a joke. You don't have to really... Dave. It's actually David, but for some reason everyone calls me Dave. It drives me crazy. Anyway, this is Droga 5. That's our building, that wedding-shaped building there. That's Droga 5. It looks so much more impressive and professional than we really are, but we're happy to be there. My story, if there is a story, is pretty basic, pretty simple, and you'll know that I'm a rambler by the ends of this little session we have together. I don't sit down and write speeches. At the end, you'll be like, maybe you should. I like to talk about what I believe and my journey, and hopefully there are things in there that you can be inspired by, and hopefully there are things you may disagree with that inspire you to do things your own way. But it's a pretty simple story, and it's my story, and I've got to stick to it, right, because it's true. But I'm a simple guy from Australia. Doesn't mean I'm an idiot, but I'm a simple guy. And I grew up in a place that's about as far away from New York and Wall Street as anyone could ever be. You know, I grew up in a ski resort in a national park in Australia called Perisher Valley, in a region called the Snowy Mountains, true name. And well, there was only two families there, and I grew up in this family. So all I really had growing up was my imagination and a desire to go and get out of this national park, even though I loved it, and conquer the world and see what was out there. And very early on, I sort of realized that there was this industry called advertising that I could sort of parlay my creativity into. And, you know, after many years of boarding school, which is where the name Droga 5 came from, and some of you know that and some of you don't know that, but basically, as I was sent to boarding school at 9, this is not a sob story, by the way, I had a great fucking time, with my brothers, I'm the fifth son in the family and I had a younger sister. My mother sewed Droga 5 on all my clothes as a laundry tag so my brothers wouldn't take my underpants and socks. And that's actually stuck, and that's why the agency's called Droga 5. It's nothing headier than that. There's no like principles of Droga 5. There wasn't five partners. It was just a laundry tag. Which goes back to really what I believe in fundamentally is start with the truth and then you can go from there. And that's something that I try and apply to everything I do. I did the classic gypsy thing, which is, you know, I started in Australia, migrated my way through Asia, as you heard, with a sort of comprehensive CV, through Europe, and I was lucky enough to end up in New York. And I got to see advertising from many facets. You know, you're still at this stage where you're trying to work out where you're going to go, what you want to do, whether advertising is for you, what facet of it you want to do it in. You don't have to have a plan. This is my starting point. You don't have to have it all sussed out and worked out. You don't. You just have to have self-belief in yourself and a pretty good idea in your own talents, and they can grow as you go along, and just throw yourself into it. And you'll find a way to flourish. And that's what happened to me. You know, I sort of was lucky that I hit the ground running right from the beginning. You know, it's weird for me being here, and even as I was being driven around this morning when I got picked up, and this is not a lie, I have this funny thing when I drive around universities and colleges. Because it's inspiring to me, because I never went to college, right? My four brothers got scholarships to a university in England called Cambridge. So there was this thing for me. They all thought that I was going to be number five to go to
either Cambridge or some university. And I was like, you know what? I don't actually want to go to university. Shock horror in my household. And I was like, you know, I think I want to go into this thing called advertising. Apoplectic shock horror. And although I convinced them, I said, I'll defer English Lit, I'll do that, but I'll just defer it, I'm going to explore. So for me, advertising was this thing that I felt from the beginning, because of who I was and where I came from, that I had to prove that it was more than just a job. That's part of, maybe that's Freudian stuff I'm putting out here. But, and I was so taken by the freedom and the range of advertising, even back then when advertising didn't have the dimension that you have and we have now. You know, we were storytellers and we could create stuff that other people would pay for and we could make it. So right from the get-go, I sort of was knuckled down and applied myself. And, I was talking to some of the other students today already, so forgive me if I'm being repetitive to you, but, I had this real belief, as cocky and as arrogant as I can be, I also have that insecurity. Like, I've always said, and I say this to anyone who'll listen to me in the office as well, to newbies, I'm like, no matter how good you think you are or talented you are, you cannot guarantee that you are more talented than anybody else. You just can't. But what you can do is you can guarantee you can work harder than anybody else. And I made that decision when I first started was, you know what? I believe I've got a unique point of view and a unique voice, but I'm going to fucking work my ass off. Excuse me, I'm a swearer. Sorry. diplomatic immunity, Australian. I'm going to work my butt off because I don't want to do things. Advertising is this thing where you sort of have to work your way up the food chain and all this. I'm like, I want my ideas to be the dictate the pace of how I succeeded. And I started by getting a job in the mailroom of Grey Advertising, actually. And it was the best way to do it, So instead of going to university, I was delivering mail to people's desks, which again had my father devastated. But it was amazing because I got to navigate an agency and I got to see how an agency worked and I got to put mail on the creative department's desks. And I used to look at their work secretly and think, that's shit, I could do better than that. And maybe I was wrong or maybe I was right, but that cockiness made me think, well, that ego inside you goes, you can do better than that. And then your insecurity goes, well, prove it. And then, I did an advertising course, a creative course, and I spent all my nights working on this, trying to find my voice. And I'm a simple person in the sense that it's not about bells and whistles. It's never been about bells and whistles. It's never been about a style. It's always been about emotion. And what I loved then is the same thing that I love now. I am taken by stuff that makes you feel something, stuff that makes you think something, stuff that resonates with you, stuff that I can relate to. Because when you start with a real truth, then you can be more creative with it. You can stretch it. You can break it. You can all these things with it because people can come back to something familiar. And I think advertising is sometimes caught up in its own shorts where it tries to be too clever or too artistic or too special effect or too, I feel like no matter what opportunities have arisen and how our advertising industry has changed, great storytelling and great stuff still resonates and it finds a way. Even in an era now where, people have, we're one of the few industries, think about this, if you're in the entertainment industry, or the music is the same thing. People invent technology to steal what you create, okay? People invented technology to avoid what we create. Now, if that's not a slap in the face to our industry that we need to create better shit, what is? So my thinking is it's simple. Let's be more creative and more strategic about what we do. And if we resonate with people will find a way. And it can be traditional, it can be non-traditional, but it's up to us and our imaginations. And that's not about being different for the sake of it. It's about really thinking like, people think that we have formulas in the office and they want to know what's the secret sauce of Droga 5 and all that sort of stuff. There's no secret sauce. There's no TM stuff apart from great people and good intentions. When I review anything in the office, my starting point is when people present to me, before we start talking about how it rolls out or what canvas it's going to live on, I start with why would anyone give a shit about this? Literally, as crude as that, maybe even cruder. Why would anyone give a shit about this? Why would this thing that we are talking about creating or making or navigating, why would anyone care about that? And if you start from that place, it keeps us it helps us keep true to the work. And because now, unlike when I first started the industry, you create something and you put a neat bow on it and just put it out there. And the clients just spent money behind it and there was an assumption that people would see it. And there's no such thing as assumptions now.
So we have to earn the right for people to want to see our work or think about our work or forward our work or get involved in our work. And when you think about people's reaction to something as part of the creative idea, it changes how you think. It doesn't, I'm not saying we're just all about user-generated stuff or anything like that, it's not about that. But thinking about people's reaction to something is part of the narrative now. You know, and I've always been a desperate, greedy, creative person who wanted to just, who really believed in the work. You know, I've always been fierce about that. And, you know, maybe my arrogance has changed more to more considered now and thoughtful. And back in the days when it was Asachi days, you know, I was just creative at all costs and I didn't really think about the other departments or all that sort of stuff. And now at Droga 5, I'm fortunate where I feel like the ecosystem of our agency is what makes our agency, what's why I bet on our agency, apart from the fact it's got my name on it. But no, but why I believe the agency, because it's not just a creative place. It's a strategic, considered, thoughtful, well-run place, great account service and all that sort of stuff. And a lot of it is luck as well. Like, I'm not going to bullshit. You know, you've got to be in the right place at the right time. But find your own luck. Like, put yourself in positions where opportunity is going to rear its head and pounce on it. Don't hesitate, right? Don't wait for what other people... Put your imprint on it and go with it. And again, going back to simple, like, I'm a ferocious reader and I like, you know, if something's of interest to you, I want to know about it. Like, if there was a sport or a hobby that someone's passionate about, I love hearing about things. Like, I, you know, you could give me the most boring thing in the world, but if someone's an expert at it, I do want to pick their brains about it and find out why someone finds it's interesting and why they care about it. And that's what our job is. Our job is to find these interesting things. Now, when we started Droga 5, you know, I was lucky to do that sort of gypsy thing around the world. And then I got to that position, and I mentioned this to some other people today, that, you know, you get, at your age, you probably think, you know, oh, my God, my goals are this, and I want to benchmark at this, and I hope to, you know, and it will all change, I promise you. But, you know, I thought that I wanted to run a network and do all that sort of stuff and have, the, you know, and you get, I got to a position where I had the title and the job and the salary and all those wonderful things that you think are wonderful, but as a creative person, I was very unhappy. And that's why I thought, you know, I'm going to quit the job that no one else would quit because I want to start my own agency and I want to test myself to see if I really am who I think I am and try that. And then that's where timing happens. And people know the agency for our first piece of work we produced, which was for Echo, the Mark Echo Air Force One thing. But what they don't realise is that actually wasn't the first thing that we worked on or conceived. The very first client I had when I was leaving Publicis with a box, it was like that cliched moment walking out of the office with a box, and the GE client came up to me and said, can we be your first client? I was like, who's not going to say yes to that? I was like, please, you know, happy to take your money and do something great. And they were an amazing client. And their first brief was for the Olympics, for, you know, the upcoming Olympics. And they were thinking, what do we do? How do we, you know, put our brand out there? And I said, I'm always, and the starting point is always like now is very much, and then was taking the gloves off and so nothing is set in stone. What is the right answer? Like we always try and investigate, like what is the right thing to do? Not what's expected. And right doesn't have to be different. Right could be traditional and straight, or right could be inventive. And if the right thing was to blow up the moon, I promise you I would present blowing up the moon. Even if I didn't know how to blow up the moon, I would present it if there was a legitimate reason to do it. And if the right thing was a traditional radio campaign, I would present that. So our thinking was, you know, they wanted to get across GE, you know, and all the wonderful things, amazing things that GE does. And we were like, instead of spending a fortune just putting billboards all over China that talk about GE, proud sponsor of, you know, the Olympics, Beijing Olympics, we said, why don't you take the same amount of money and build a building in the center of Olympic Park that harnesses all the technology that you do from solar, that actually purifies water, that takes the river that runs through Beijing and purifies the water, and you turn it into an information center, and have a campaign that lasts forever. So take the same money it would cost you to, and you can build a building that'll be a statement forever, a living, breathing brand. Philippe Starck came and designed it for us. We flew to China, presented it. Everyone was on board, although the budget was about $80 million, so it was way over money. And again, we're like three people. But it was more, they didn't do it, obviously. You would have heard about it if they did it.
But there were a lot of legitimate reasons why, and we thought we were going to do it. And at the time, I was like, this is unbelievable. It's like, you know, we're a very new agency, and we presented this to a client who was expecting billboards and TV ads, that they should build a building that cleans the water of Beijing. I'm like, what better communication statement is that for GE and your commitment to China than that? And for legitimate reasons, it didn't happen because of politics and da-da-da-da and logistics and all that. But for a brief period of time, we were investigating building a building, and that still has there's a big framed thing in my office of that picture, of that building. Reminds me every day, like, you know what? Just present what you really think is the right thing, even if you don't know how you're going to do it. And from there on, we've had that same attitude. And from there, it went to Mark Echo, where we presented the idea of implying that we, you know, spray painted graffiti on Air Force One, and we had to rent a 747, and, or, you know, like, my thing is, like, just do what you're right, you know, and what's right for one is not necessarily right for another. What was right for GE was not right for Mark Echo. What was right for Mark Echo, trying to convince him to hire a 747. And I was telling some students before, the faculty, when I first did the Mark Echo piece, and if you don't know it, it's fine. If you do, that's good. You know, we implied that Mark Echo had, some graffiti artists had you know, raided Andrews Air Force Base and spray painted graffiti on Air Force One because he was a graffiti artist. And when I first presented the script, it was one of the classic things where I wrote this script because I'd read this book about graffiti, because I didn't know anything about graffiti. And that's where, again, I tell you, know what you're talking about. Read. Don't go in there just thinking. Like, the more that you understand their issue and their problem, the better chance you have. And I went in there and I presented this script to Mark Echo. I read this script about, you know, and these kids, they break into Andrews Air Force, da-da-da, and they spray thing and evade the security. And his first comment to me was, and I was thinking, is he going to laugh me out of the room? He's like, can one of these guys die? I was like, what? He's like, yeah, can we kill one of them? I'm like, oh, my God. I'm thinking, we're so going to work out this together. This is going to be amazing. But, you know, obviously one of them can't die, but the fact that you're thinking even braver than me makes me feel conservative. And there was legitimate reasons that shouldn't happen, but it was, again, like, because the story would have been about that, not about, but that's the whole thing, like, present what you think is right. Clients actually are braver than you think they are and smarter than you think they are and want you to be confident enough to walk in and present what you think is right. And that wasn't about doing something that's different or anything like that. And that's been my belief ever since. I wanted to show you something, and I asked my office to edit this, and it's really weird because I don't want to show too many things, but I thought, how can I condense? Our 10th anniversary is in May, and I thought, can I tell Droga 5 in like 8 minutes? So bear with me, okay? Let's see if this technology works. Okay.
Artist pulled off an internet hoax that even got the attention of the White House.
We're going to throw in his whole life here in NZ. Clothes, his parents, maybe even his girlfriend Emma.
UNICEF's tap project, it helps millions of kids get clean water.
This is the biggest project for UNICEF in 56 years.
You didn't think what life was going to be like
for me.
Mom. Dad.
Introducing Help. I want to save a life. A package of over-the-counter bandages that also doubles as a simple marrow donor registry kit.
The city is moving ahead with what it calls its Million Motivation Campaign, a pilot program that officials hope will push kids to get serious about their education.
Is for sport, and they are the champions.
Jay-Z is releasing a new book titled Decoded.
The pages of the book have been showing up all over the country. It's in all different shapes and sizes.
So if you go to bing.com/Jay-Z, it takes you on an online adventure to find the pages of Decoded.
People
People are upset with a new fast food ad.
Why you not have a job?
It features a grandmother.
You are going to hell.
Telling her granddaughter.
You dressed like a prostitute.
Did she just call me a prostitute?
It is truly the first sunrise of the next phase of your life.
Day one, first day of my retirement. First day I've never had to answer to anybody for anything.
This is like having summer vacation for real.
It was for these men that we created Newcastle Brown Ale. Little did they know, 85 years later, we'd exploit their miserable lives to sell more beer.
This is Thunderclap, the first crowd-speaking platform that allows you to lend your voice to causes and ideas you believe in. From the first ever Thunderclap for Wall Street reform, to the United Nations joining forces with Beyonce and harnessing Thunderclap to send 1 billion social media messages at the same time.
'93 was a war zone in New York.
Any human being is concerned with something out there in the world.
No matter how things change, what makes us wholesome never will. Honey Maid, this is wholesome.
The only beer that ever promised me a high-paying role in a commercial and then backed out at the last second like a bunch of
Happy 4th of July, America. Ready to fire up the grill and celebrate our victory over the Brits?
You have the wrong body for ballet. And at 13, you are too old to be considered.
Something is your passion, it never dies. Never goes away.
Class. Artistry. Chad.
The UNICEF Tap Project challenges you to put down your phone. Every 10 minutes you don't touch your phone, our sponsors and donors can fund a day of clean water for a child in need.
The Newcastle Band of Brands. We're looking for brands. Like, I don't know, maybe your brand. To chip in for an ad we can all be proud of, because all 20 to 30 brands are crammed into it.
Robin Hood and Little John walking through the forest, laughing back and forth at what the other has to say.
I've been away for 11 months. That's amazing. I'm all of a sudden outside playing with my kids.
These are cows. And all of this manure has hydrogen in it. Let's see if we can use that hydrogen to get a car to really run on bull.
Oil Creek is where oil was first found. That's why it's called Oil Creek.
With the water we collected, 150 gallons worth, that's enough to electrolyze and fill over a dozen Toyota Mirais.
I want to be an event planner.
Really?
I do. I want to come in and look at a room and say, this is what we're going to do.
I said orchids.
Bring in the ice sculptures.
Quilted Northern works so well, people can forget their bathroom experience. But Sir Froggy can never forget.
I'm not your grandma. Just a handsome, kind-hearted drifter who wandered in years ago and stayed for all the yummy sausage.
Nap time.
Where?
Back to the future!
bet your ass it works.
If you want a sausage numb, I request humor.
When you cook, you have to have a comfortable kitchen. Italian passionates make a good food.
Thousands of people came to the Race for Retirement and pledged to save an additional 1% of their income. If we all do that, we can all win.
I'm Hillary Clinton, and I've always approved this message.
Dear birth mother and dear birth father, I am searching for you.
You gay?
It's okay.
I know who you are.
Nothing would stop me from loving you.
Exhausting watching that. It's funny, there was some of my, actually a few of my favourite things were missing. I was like, what? Great Schlepp and things like that. But anyway, I mean, it's interesting for me to look at that, because actually I have this rule in the office about when we present to clients for new business, we're not allowed to present anything that's older than a year old, no matter how much I like it or we like it. We have to present stuff that we've done in the last 12 months. And we do that for twofold. I mean, obviously there's the effect and the statement that makes to clients, saying that we have enough confidence in the work that we're doing right now, and that we're not living off past glory. And the message it also sends internally is that we have to be about now. Like, what are we doing right now? As much as, you know, that's why looking at some of those things, I haven't shown it, some of those things that are some of our greatest hits, I haven't shown a client in years. You know what I mean? And it's quite funny to look at that. But also it makes me laugh. I'm thinking, God, some of the things that we were thinking and the asks in some of this stuff is so outrageous, but it's not. And what I mean by that is, on paper, there's a million responsible reasons not to do majority of that. Very smart, well-educated people could find a legitimate reason why this doesn't work, or that wouldn't be done, or that hasn't been done before, or you could make more money if you did something else on it. All of those reasons are trumped by, well, people don't say that in my office, but also by the fact that it's the right thing to do. We are very, very, you know, the creatively led, no question, strategically driven. There's a purpose in everything we create. We never present something just because it's creative or it's different. There has to be a legitimate reason for it, and it has to be authentic to the opportunity at hand. And that's not to say everything is life-defining and massively life-changing, but there has to be a red thread that drives back to the brand and the client and why. And what's been fascinating is, and even just looking at those things, there are some crazy things there that if I presented cold to a client without them understanding a process and why, they would think we're absurd. I mean, there's things, going back to one of our first things. One of my favorite things we ever did was, never really got a big play because it was a tiny client, was for a beer brand called Steinlager. And it was like our third thing we ever did. And it was a New Zealand beer launching in America. And when we presented to the client, I'm like, well, you know, I had to insult the client to sell the campaign. I'm like, look, New Zealand, you're a tiny country. And the fact that an educated, very successful marketing director is being moved from New Zealand to New York to do it, I said, that's going to cause a brain drain in New Zealand. You have to replace, you can't afford to lose one educated person. So our campaign is, we're going to give away your life in New Zealand. Someone's going to win your job at Steinlager and win your girlfriend and win all your friends. And they're like, yeah, let's do it. So we created a campaign that where someone won their life. It's actually amazing. They went down to New Zealand for 6 months. Outrageous. But I love the fact that you can create things like that, or you jump to things like Bing, or you jump to things where the asks don't make sense because there isn't a media channel for it. But the thing you'll find is people want to collaborate with interesting things and cultural things. Everybody out there wants to do something. And if there's an authentic ask that is mutually beneficial, you can open any door. And that's what I find amazing. And not, as I said, I'm not saying we're chasing different or being obscure or innovative for the sake of it. But advertising touches so many things. You know, there are things in there that are just hardcore selling and building brands, and I'm proud of that. There are things in there that sort of rub up and touch societal things from UNICEF or from UN or things like that. And, you know, one of the things I'm proudest of is, for instance, Thunderclap. You know, it's something we created with our own incubator, which is one of the biggest social amplifiers. Like, I love that. That's maybe never going to make, I mean, it actually makes a little bit of money, but it's never really going to make money. But some really smart people, engineers in our office, thought of that. And that, what that does and the impact it has is amazing. And that's how we measure our stuff. It's like, what does it do? What does it really do? We're not bullshitting ourselves about how good we think something is. And we, you know, we're not always right. No agency is always right. And I, as people have heard me say, like, you know, we don't have a monopoly on all the best ideas and the best people, and we're always looking for new people, always. Every great agency is looking for new opinions to come around the table. I'm not looking for more people to come to the agency and agree with me. I'm looking for more people who have their own opinion and are in line with what we're all aiming for. And that's the thing, it's the variety that we have as an industry that is so much more interesting now than it was when I started the industry. The industry you're going into is so much more interesting than the industry I'm going into, I started in. You know, beyond the shitty title, you know, the future is yours, whatever that stupid thing was. Like, I really believe that. Like, I really believe the industry you're going into, albeit maybe more intimidating because it's not as defined, is more exciting because you can express yourself and you don't have to, there's not a hierarchical thing where when I started the industry, it was expected that you would work on collateral for a year and then DM and then you'd migrate up to radio ads and you do, like, it doesn't work that way anymore. Whatever you, whether you're coming in for planning or creative or account service, like, you, the opportunity might be from a tiny client that could become a blockbuster and the impact. And who doesn't want to have a job where not only you're paid to do this, to have an opinion, holy shit, revelation, that's amazing, paid to be creative, unbelievable. You can have 1 minute you can be talking to a hip-hop star or a president or a startup or a Fortune 10 CEO, and all of them need what we have, lateral thinking. They all need it. We're not, you know, I'm not overstepping our importance in the world. We are still advertising. You know, there are great agencies out there that do work that I admire. Like, I just like stuff that makes me think and feel. That's it. And that's my little zone. And I want that feeling to connect it to a brand and a client. And, you know, and it's simple, but it's hard to be simple. It's hard to keep it easy. Do you know what I mean? And it's an industry that puts a lot of parameters up. You know, we're an industry, whoever compromises at least wins. You know, but for me personally, I find it easier to try and be great than to spend my time trying to justify mediocrity. And that's the choice that I made. You know, and I feel like that's the choice you will make when you, whatever, you know, careers and agencies, you'll have to make choices. Like, what do I believe in? Are my beliefs more important than self-preservation? I'm talking this within a career perspective. You know what I mean? And that's what you'll be faced with at many times. And it's a game. And just fucking do what you believe in and what your voice is and all the sensibilities that you have is from home and the things that make you who you are, your relationship with your brother or your mother or your father or your weird uncle or your teacher that inspired you. And just bring all that into bear and just shove it in your work and your voice. And you'll create potentially great things. And if you don't, then do something else. But you know what I mean? Like, I really believe that, you know, let me see what else we've got here. A few other things and I'll shut up. Again, like, I also like sometimes being smart and trying to think of ways of expressing things in different. So this is for Android. Where we're going to go, but. And then this one that we launched last night at the Oscars, and this is the 60. I'm so obsessed with the 90. It's the 90 makes me cry a little bit. And then there's a whole digital campaign around this, and there's apps and there's everything, but it's just a really simple story, which is, again, and I was telling some of the people earlier, like, you know, when I was reviewing the work for Android, creatives, I try not to have people bring me just big, you know, like fleshed out things, and it was one line in a 50 pages of scripts and ideas that just said, well, I won't say it until you see that, if you haven't seen it, so I won't say what it is, but I'll say it at the end. Whatever. Oh, that's not it. Sorry. I'm so soppy. I fucking love that. So when they presented me, it was just one line on a page that said, you know, imagine if rock, paper, scissors could be friends. I was like, of course, it's genius. I said, because they can all kill each other, but they can all protect each other. One can protect, you know, I'm like, there's something beautiful and universal, and you know, it's anti-bullying, it's racial, it's cultural, it's like, I'm like, it's whatever you want it to be, but there's just something, you know, great story, and it's familiar, you know what I mean, like grounded in something that is so obvious, everyone knows. And people asked me today earlier, like, what is advice about creative process? I'm like, maybe I said before, start with the obvious, start with something obvious that's familiar, and then you can fuck with it, you can bend it and stretch it, and you can be more creative with it. And it doesn't, you know, not everything should be soppy, not everything should be tear-jerking, not everything should be societal, not everything, you know, sometimes known as driving around in little houses is the right thing to sell sausage, yes? And sometimes you can try and help a president get elected, and sometimes you can help try and raise money. That's the beauty of our industry. More and more people need us. I've said it before. They need what you are starting. You're all nervous and anxious now about where you're going to go, what you're going to do, which agency, if agencies, whatever. People need great fresh thinkers, and you'll be surprised at the people that you meet who do need it. You know, we're not just selling stuff off shelves. You know, and I have this saying which people, you know, it's just true, like, even people who advertising has I don't know if it has an unfair rep, because maybe it's self, you know, we created it ourselves by bombarding people with crappy advertising. But I always equate it to, like, you know, if you go to a dinner party or a barbecue with friends, and, you know, you meet someone and they're like, and you're like, what do you do? And they said, oh, I'm a writer. I write books. You immediately think, oh my God, what great books have they written? If you met someone, they're like, oh, I'm in film. You'd be like, oh my God, what great film have you written? If someone said, oh, I'm in advertising, you're like, what shitty ads have they done? And it's sort of held hostage, right? It's a bit unfair. And you guys can be the ones that change that. You know what I mean? And we all can. And as I said, you'll be surprised by the people you meet. I mean, I was joking with some of the students, but clearly you're all feel the burn people because you're that age. But it's important, just understand, Hillary's the only one that can defeat that crazy man. Just know that. So, see if this
One of the areas that I've been particularly interested in is the area of children.
All of us have a responsibility to ourselves, to our children, to each other.
We intend to be sure that everybody in this room and every child in this state is somebody.
No matter where they're born, no matter to whom they are born, our children's future is shaped both by the values of their parents and the policies of their nation.
It's time to protect the next generation. Fill the lives of our children with possibility and hope. Open up the doors so that every child has a chance to live up to his or her God-given potential.
I've spent my life fighting for children, families, and our country, and I'm not stopping now.
Clinton, and I've always approved this message.
Everybody needs great thinking. Everybody needs better communicators. And wherever you stand politically, whatever, you know, it's we're a lucky few. And Droga 5, we are who we are. We've made mistakes. We still, you know, sometimes we're sprinting forward, sometimes we're falling forward. But, you know, I'm no different now, and I'm still as excited and curious and restless as I honestly was when I first started in the industry. I really was. You know, I was desperate to make my mark. And even now, with all the successes we've had, and I've got privilege to have so many great people and a great culture, we're still trying to make our mark because it's a fickle industry and it's an unforgiving industry as a service industry. And if you force yourself to give a shit, like genuinely give a shit, I guarantee you success. You can't put it on a bumper sticker, but I guarantee you that. And I wish you all the best. Thank you.
Questions? We
only have time for one question.
Oh, sorry, make it a good one. Come on. Is Australia pound for pound the greatest sporting nation in the world? Yes. Okay, let's just start. Oh, it is. I'll go head to head with anyone on that one. Sorry. Great question. Bad question. Any question?
This is one question. Bang all the way up here. Hey, how's it going?
Good, how are you?
That's the question.
Yes, exactly.
So it's been clear that there's no real way to measure creativity. So how do you ensure that with your interns and people on all your staff that you make sure that you get people you believe are the best possible fit for Droga 5 and to make the best creative ads?
Well, you know, you judge it on the thinking that they bring to bear. You judge it on how they assimilate themselves into a culture and what they contribute. As I said, well, I'm not looking for a repetition of something I've already got. This is going to sound weird. It's also, obviously the younger generation, everyone thinks that they're already CEO when the minute they walk in there. So it's, you know, do they have enough confidence to speak up when they should and enough confidence to not speak up when they should? You know, just you don't have to talk to say anything, right? It's the value of what comes out of your mouth. And, you know, just how they fit in the weird ecosystem that is our agency. You know, we've got some pretty quirky, crazy, and it's a very weird alchemy in our agency. Can't describe it. It's corridor conversations. It's casual. It's very, very driven and competitive, but not in an aggressive way. But people take pride in other people's success. Like, I know when someone does something, a team will be jealous of it, but also I know that their thinking is, well, I'm going to outdo that in my next thing. You know, and there's no like pocket of stars and other people doing the sort of shoveling the coal. It's everyone has opportunity. If you give everyone opportunity, and I feel like anyone who comes in, if they, you know, respectful and listen and try and observe and sprinkle their opinions and fingerprints. But you know, who here knows they want to be in advertising? Who here's not sure? There you go. I mean, there's no right answer, by the way. I'm just curious. You know what I mean? But there's, you know, there's great agencies. There's some great agencies all over the world. You know what I mean? And you can take your talents and your ambitions anywhere, and you can apply it anywhere, and it'll take you around the world, and you can have a shit ton of fun doing it. And it's hard. It's a hard industry, right? Because it's subjective, and anything subjective is fraught with issues, and you've got to sustain that. You've got to have a thick skin, and you can't become so precious that you take things personally, even though it is very personal. You know, because anytime you're putting your imagination, your thought out there, it's a personal thing, no matter whether you pretend it's not. And you have to have a healthy combination of, as I said it before, ego and insecurity. Like, you really do. You know, I'll fight hard for what I believe in, and if I can't sell it or they're not buying it, my ego says to me, well, I'm going to come back with something better anyway. Which drives people crazy. But, you know, because as soon as you present something shitty, they'll buy it. So, you know, that's it. That was a bizarre answer.
That's a
small gift for you. You have to open it. It's a tradition.
I have to open it?
Yes, you need to open
it. I have to open it.
30 seconds left. Sorry, we are not going to take any questions. The reason why? Because David's, flight is 7:30. He has to leave right now. Otherwise, he'll be so late. He won't be able to.